Hi, everybody. Am I visible? Everyone, can you just give me a thumbs up or like a yes if I'm visible and I'm audible? Okay, great. Perfect. So, hi and welcome to the first edition of Pratisandhi's webinar series. I know it's a tough time because of the lockdown, but that's why we've tried to create awareness about sexual health while you sit at home. So us, Pratisandhi, we're a youth-run organization which is dedicated towards creating awareness and talking about social norms that surrounds it, and promoting dialogue about it. And to do the same, today we have our guest speaker, who is Pallavi Mahajan. Pallavi Mahajan is a lawyer, a gender consultant, and the co-founder of the Azaad Initiative, which was also given UN volunteer status recently. In addition to that, Pallavi Mahajan is also the Indian representative of the Global Goodwill Ambassador of 2019 for empowering women of 192 countries. And so today we're gonna talk about why feminism is not the new F word and everything that we need to know about feminism. But just before we begin, just some quick things that you need to know. Is that we're going to have a question and answer round once Pallavi is done giving her presentation. And secondly, you can type in all the questions that you have in the general chat box. If you could see, it is right below the attendees on your right-hand corner. It's a chat box icon. If you press that, you can write in your questions. And at the end of the session, Pallavi can just read all of them and she'll answer them. Great? Is everybody through this with this much? If you can just type in a yes or something. Okay, great. So I'll just begin to share my screen and we'll start with the session.
Hi, good evening, everyone. I am...
Pallavi?
Yeah, so just a quick yes if I'm audible, please. Okay, great. So, hi, and it's wonderful that we all could catch up during these lockdown times. And it's been a great initiative by Pratisandhi to discuss certain critical issues which bother all of us. But because of hula hoop of time, we are not able to give due credit to these particular subjects. Now, coming to the subject that we will be discussing today, is feminism the new effort? So, where it actually begins is to understand that how did the entire journey of feminism as an ideology began? What were the basic fragments over the years? How did it develop more? Then what is the criticism attached to it? And then in 2020, do we really need feminism? Right. So first, we will understand feminism by going to the literary definition of feminism without any bias. So what feminism basically is if you can read, if you can see the slide, it means that It is to define, establish, and achieve, right? So these are the three fragments of feminism. We define it, we establish feminism, and then we achieve certain motives through feminism. So what are the three motives that, things that we achieve through feminism? The first is social movements. So what does social movement pertain to? It means social critical fabric that we live in, say maternity rights, the rights of a marriage, the rights of a property, etc. Political movements are basically the suffragette rights, that is right to vote and right to representation, specifically in the legislature. And the third is ideology. So over the years since feminism began, that is through the two world wars, it was first a very reformist movement, then became a radical movement, and then it became a revolutionary movement. Now, by establishment of these three definition roles, there are certain objectives that feminism over the years has tried to establish. The first is political equality. Like today in 2020, you see women representing you in various legislators, executive and judiciary, and various other fragments of the society. But back in time, women were not given this kind of right. They were not even given right to vote. So what feminism basically pertains to is political equality, that I need to have as a gendered minority the same political rights, which maybe the the power, the, which basically a man enjoys in the social fabric. Then coming to economic equality. Economic equality in today's time is definitely gender pay. But back in time, how did economic equality come into being is representation of women to economic independence. Now, going back in time, we all know, I mean, we have emerged from the male breadwinner model where women were only relegated to the caregiving duties at home. But today we talk about women going all out to earn their own bread. But back in time, feminism also took one very important ambition, and that was of economic equality. That is equal opportunity to earn money. Now coming to personal equality. Personal equality pertains to, say, rights in a marriage, sexual and reproductive rights, right to abortion, maternal rights, or even right to freely move about in the country. And the last is social equality. Social equality takes into cognizance the social fabric that we are living in. So basically, the right to visibility, right to consent, right to the desire, right to opine, right to make sure that we have the privilege of talking about freely the agonies that we go through and the ambitions that we uphold. Now, one thing that we have to understand about feminism is that though all these things, political equality, economic equality, this all started with the women empowerment movement. But today and of late, feminism is about all the sexes. Feminism has nothing to do with only catering to the needs and the ambitions and the equality movement of women. It is to cater to the entire gender spectrum. So feminism taking cognizance of all these four ingredients, but the entire gender spectrum. Coming to the next slide. Yeah, thank you. So before we delve into where feminism starts today, it is very important to understand the history of feminism. So as it is mentioned, Charles Fourier, who was a sociologist, is credited with having coined the word feminism in 1837. So that is when the word feminism, taking inspiration from the feminine, that is woman, actually came into being. But over the years, the feminist movement across the globe have differed in causes. So causes could be anything. Causes could be your two world wars. Causes could be the Me Too movement in today's time. Causes could be the Black Lives Matter movement. So these are the causes that gave gravitas to the entire feminist movement. Now coming to goals. Now, during the entire feminist journey, we have seen that every feminist movement has had certain pertaining roles. Maybe in the beginning, it was to make sure that there is abolition of oppression. Maybe today it is about gender equality. It is about generation 50-50 that we are hoping to achieve through United Nations Sustainable Development Goals 2050. Now, what are the intentions? So the intentions of feminism have also been debated upon, where certain people think that that over the years, feminism has lost its glory. It has just become about male bashing. So that in every history, in every period of feminism, there were intentions attached. The first intention could be of equality. The second intention could be of making sure that their voice is equally heard. And the third intention maybe could be used to intersectionality. Now, all these are also dependent upon certain bullets, which are time, culture, and society. So as the world moves, our ideologies change, our understanding of the world changes. So what was prevalent in the 1940s regarding the feminist movement may not be of, maybe regressive in today's time and age, right? So time is a very important tool to understand how feminist ideologies have emerged. Now, coming to culture also. Now, not just in India, where obviously our cultural fabric has emerged really well in the last few years, specifically in regard to feminist movement, but throughout the world, even in the most developed economies also, we've seen a massive cultural change, which has always benefited or maybe got a disorder in the feminist movement. So culture has a very important part to play in the feminist movement. And the last is country. So we all know that we are divided between the developed and the developing economies. And throughout the feminist movement, we have seen that there have been different phases of feminism in different countries. Maybe the Western world equipped itself to feminism a little early than the third world countries. So this is the brief history outline of feminism. Now we'll move to the next slide. Yeah. So, Now, this is something that is very debated, that are they really prevalent waves to feminism? So what are waves to feminism is that throughout the feminist history movement, we've divided feminism under four waves: first, second, third, and fourth. Now, certain feminists across the globe believe that this is a very crass interpretation of feminism, because feminism is never a monolithic movement where a particular movement eloped in without taking cognizance of the entire world, or without taking cognizance of the preceding or predecessor feminist movements. So certain people debate about it, certain feminists, very well-renowned feminists, that debate about it, that feminism is a whole. Feminism cannot be divided into waves. But there is also a group of feminists that understand that feminism needs to be given a structure, to understand that feminism is not holier than thou, that feminism has also suffered through the ages, that the feminism has also taken the brunt of how ideologies has changed. So the first wave of feminism was 1848 to 1920. This basically emerged in the English-speaking world, which is the UK and the US. And what was this feminism basically about was a feminism of abolition, right? So this is a feminism of reforms, where there was where women started delving a little more outside their caregiving duties, where they started advocating that we have a right to move outside our houses, that we have a right, and the most important right to the first wave of feminism that women established was the right to vote. So why is it important is to understand that the English-speaking world before the two first world were dictating the entire socio-economic and cultural fabric of the world. So there, women were relegated to basic mannequin display at homes. They were not given any rights. And specifically, the right to vote was supposed to be a right of the elitist. And it was given to the ones who have, in the very crude terms, have brains. And so women who were supposed to be the latter end of the table were not supposed to be the ones who are supposed to decide that who is to stand at the legislature. So one of the most critical rights that the first wave of feminism established was the feminism of women's suffrage, that is the right to vote. Furthermore, there was also a period where there was an abolition of a lot of evil practices in the world, be it be marital rape. There was not abolition, but the talk started happening around these areas. There were also talks around how many children or how, when a woman can say no to more children. Furthermore, there were talks about that a woman has to have equitable respect at home. So all these things started happening during the first wave of feminism. Now coming to the second wave of feminism. Now, the second wave of feminism, the period is 1963 to 1980. That is, it is post-World War II. So one very important aspect of the world wars is specifically in today's time when we are going through a pandemic is that whenever the world has gone through any kind of economic crisis, now, in the latter time, it was the World War, very positive effects of feminism, very positive growth in feminism has been observed. Like in the Second World War, it was the first time that women with children and women who were pregnant joined the workforce. They joined the workforce as insurance. So what was insurance was basically that the ideology said that women can only work when the crisis at home is so major that the male breadwinner model cannot sustain the entire family. So that was a good movement towards feminism, because that started moving towards economic independence. So what did we see during the second wave of feminism, which was again in the Western world, UK and the US, was endopatriarchy. So endopatriarchy is that, obviously, even today in 2020, we do not debate that it is an endopatriarchy. But endopatriarchy basically means that women started opining against the ill discrimination at home and at workplace. So they started opining about their equitable disposition as the man in the economy, in the household. They also started asking about right to education. So if you go back to your old Jane Austen and your Virginia Woolf books or literature, if you have studied, or even to the gender norms that we have studied in India, right to education was again an elitist right, which was supposed to be useless for women who were supposed to eventually cater to their one and only ambition, that was a caregiving model. That is, you take care of the house, you give birth to the child, you make sure the man in the house is very happy, and you make sure that the household is a good, comfortable position, good, comfortable home for your man to return back to. But now is when women started asking for a right to education. Now, it started with very basic rights like finishing schools. That was the inception of finishing schools, and finishing schools started holding a lot of, taking into cognizance a lot of gravity. But it also started to establish the primary and the secondary education, not just to make sure that women are nurtured well on the marital regime, but right to education became a right of choice for women. Then equal economic opportunity. So this is when women started joining the workforce as a working class. Now, before the second wave of feminism, the working class was limited only to men. Only through the second wave of feminism that we started seeing women coming into the economic sphere. Now, even for the developing economies, 1970s to 1980s was a period where we saw women earning money, where women contributing to the household income, where women going out and started asking for equitable rights at workplace. The other important development due to second wave of feminism were also marital rights. So where in the first wave of feminism, there were talks about marital rape and consent, but it was still a very unheard issue. It was taken for granted that sex is supposed to be an outgoing and a very natural outgoing of a marriage, as in you couldn't debate as to when a woman wants to indulge in sex or has the right to say no to sex to her partner, specifically, I mean, to her husband. But now is when women started debating about that, is the byproduct of sex from marriage actually that equitable? Are women always available to cater to the sexual and needs of the partner, of the husband? And the talk started happening around these areas. Now coming to the third wave of feminism. So third wave of feminism is very interesting. It is the wave of feminism which has actually received the most brunt from the gender studies equitable group, because what has been the critique for the third wave of feminism is that the women, specifically, they are named as the granddaughters of the feminist who started the feminist movement in the first wave. So these granddaughters took for granted all the work that the feminists across the globe in the first and the second wave have done. And they started taking the entire glory through the third wave of feminism and negating the entire work and holding the second wave and first wave feminists to be anti-feminist movement. So this wave of feminism is also critiqued to class and to caste. Feminists across the globe, instead of focusing on the sex, on the gender, and starting a solidarity movement, started more focusing on the class and the caste that they came from. So there was also disfragmentation during this particular feminism. So the most basic example, which any of you who has been interested in or enthusiastic about women's studies and gender study must have read, is Anita Hill's example, which emerges from the US, where she had put allegations on the then Chief Justice of the Supreme Court in the US, who was a person of African-American descent, saying that she was a victim of sexual harassment on the hands of that Chief Justice. Now, a very strong group of feminists across the globe started taking a nudge at Anita Hill, saying that she has disregarded her genes. She has disregarded the only time their minority class was making a move towards coming in the representation of the three pillars of democracy. And there was a lot of upheaval in the feminist movement regarding this. However, there was also a positive, there were a lot of positive ideologies that came through third wave of feminism. Now, though it started in the 1990s, some believe that the third wave of feminism is still going on, but again, getting back to structure, which I believe is very necessary to define the feminist movement, we will enter the feminist movement of third wave in 2010. So this is the third wave of feminism where a lot of positive outlooks were established, specifically related to intersectionality. Now, before the third wave of feminism, in the first and the second wave, it was all about women's rights movement. The LGBTQIA were neither recognized, and obviously if they were not recognized, they were not talked about. There was only hush-hush about gender being non-binary. So, but in during the third wave of feminism is where intersectionality started holding its ground, where people started coming out as in a gender spectrum which is not divided into male and female alone. And a lot of support from the established feminists, be it be from any gender, were towards giving access to and towards giving representation to the intersectional feminist movements. And then the second one was about sex positivity. So one other aspect of third wave of feminism was that it was divided into two groups in the US. The first group debated that it had that during the third wave of feminism, there has to be very strict laws against pornography. So this group of feminists believe that pornography is the last resort that a woman would indulge into. And because pornography is basically focused on women giving the pleasure or woman being subject of the pleasure, therefore, it was biased and it promoted violence in sexual intercourse. However, there was this another group of feminists also who believed that sex is, women can indulge and can represent and can define sex in whichever way possible. And sex itself, it needs to be taken in a very positive fashion and not just in a pious fashion. So there can be different fragments attached to sexual intercourse and women need to have the right to define it in their way. So that is when, for the first time, sex as a positive notion, as a need of the body, started holding ground. And so this was a great establishment of the third wave of feminism. Now coming to leadership representation. Now 1990-2010 also saw a lot of economic representation of women in the leadership roles. So before, in the second wave of feminism, we saw that women started entering the workforce in the bourgeois class, but in the third wave of feminism, they started calling the taps. They started having the leadership position. So with leadership position came into being the power dynamics, that is the decision-making authority. So women started holding the decision-making authority in certain aspects also. Also now started the talk about gender violence. Now, it is very important to understand that any kind of revolution throughout the globe, not just feminist revolutions, but other poverty related to poverty, health, class, caste divides, any kind of revolution has had an equal negative force to snub it. And the negative force that started snubbing the third wave of feminism was gender violence. Be it in the form of domestic violence, be it in the form of mental violence, or be it in the form of sexual harassment at workplace. But the third wave of feminism also gave charge to opinions, to dialogue, to interactions, to even start talking about any kind of gender violence prevalent through the third wave of feminism or through the last two wave of feminism that were established. Now coming to the fourth wave of feminism. So fourth wave of feminism is the feminism that you and I are living in. So it started in the 2000s. And fourth wave of feminism is the social media and the digital media wave of feminism. It's when women, and specifically, now we will not talk about women because now from the third wave of feminism, feminism has been established as an intersectional movement. So all the feminists across the globe, they started using their digital and social media presence to advocate about equality in the entire gender spectrum. So two very important outcomes of the fourth wave of feminism, which I'm sure most of us are aware of, is Time Is Up campaign and Me Too movement. So Me Too movement was about sexual harassment at workplace, and Time Is Up is also about various kind of discrimination that women have, that genders have faced across the globe in various other fragments of the society. So these were the two very important aspects of fourth wave of feminism. And then started the other aspects. One was My Body, My Choice. Now, most of you must be also aware that abortion, though are very, the laws related to abortion are very progressive in our country, in India. However, across the globe, the abortion laws are not that very progressive, but women started talking about it. They started debating that if I have the onus of giving birth to a child, then I decide if I have to, when I have to, and how I have to. Similarly, slut walk started happening, because fourth wave of feminism is also the time when women started reclaiming the words that were in the first and the second wave of feminism described as unholy for women. So cunt, slut, bitch, these are the words that women started owning, that they represent my personality, so there is no hush-hush about it. If I come out as a bitch, I come out as a badass woman. I come out as a woman who has fought through all the odds to establish an opinion of my own today in the society. So women started redefining these words and reclaiming these words. Another aspect of feminism that from 2010 to the present that we have seen is LGBTQIA community across the globe getting the legitimate place to sit across the table. So including India and various other democracies in the world have given a legal sanction to the LGBTQI community, which was a great win for the feminist movement across the globe. And that is when the hashtag love is love or love wins started holding talks. So this was the fourth wave of feminism, which is still going on. Now, two aspects of feminism that we are debating across the world is Sustainable Development Goals 2050. In that we are across the globe, we are working towards Sustainable Development Goal number 5, which is gender parity, where we talk about all the four aspects that we discussed in the first slide, the definition of feminism, social equality, political equality, cultural equality, economic equality, is now that we want that a 50-50 world is established, taking cognizance of these four aspects up till 2050. And the second important throughout the globe campaign that we are running towards the fourth wave of feminism is generation equality, where we make sure that there is equitable representation of genders in all the leadership positions, so that the policies, the ideologies are equally represented in the whole of the society. So this is the four wave of feminism that have happened across the globe. Now coming to the next slide, please. Now, feminism in India, because I'm assuming that most of us belong to India. So I thought that it is a little more important to discuss how far we have moved in our feminist struggles in India, not because most of us belong to India, but also because India's feminist movements have been an inspiration for a number of democracies across the globe. First, because we are one of the most populous countries in the world. And the second is that India is a melting pot of various religion, ideologies, gendered beliefs, etc. So if India is able to make a positive move towards any kind of revolution, that automatically becomes an inspiration for the other democracies, for other geographies to establish and to get inspired from. So coming to feminism in India, we'll go to the next slide, please. So let's come to the background first. So most of us know that the gender ratio, the sex ratio in India is really bleak. Male and female, we have 924 females to 1,000 males. A lot of it is also due to infanticide and feticide, because even today, a girl child is supposed to be a burden on the family. A very new example is that out of 24 villages about in Haryana, out of all the villages in Haryana, about 24 villages have not seen a single girl child in the last 7 years. So this is obviously not a coincidence that they were not able to give birth to a girl child in the last 7 years, but it is also because infanticide and feticide were so prevalent that girl child never saw the face of the day in the last 7 years. Now coming to feminization of poverty, which is also very prevalent in India. So across the globe, about the contribution of women. So here I'm only talking about women because the data related to the LGBTQIA community is in India specifically is very shadow, because as you all know, only in 2018 we gave a legal sanction to the LGBTQI community. So if the global average of the GDP that the women contribute to is 31%, in India it's not even half. It is 14.4%. And out of that 14.4%, also 60% is unaccounted for. So you see, the feminization of poverty comes more into force into global around the global pandemics that we are dealing in today. Because 60% is unaccounted for, the government will not be able to give them a safety net in case of the global crisis that we are going through. Now, other aspect of feminist movement in India is always caste system. So Dalit, Bahujan and Adivasi, the DBA group, is always the is the group which faces the worst of feminist regressive ideology. So caste system is actually the root cause of most of the socio-economic and socio-cultural battles that India has fought. Now, coming to the labor force. Now, in any workforce-oriented country, specifically in, like India, the workforce is the foundation of a strong economy because the workforce makes sure that the economy is strong. But in India, despite the women being burdened with work, both the unpaid care labor at home and otherwise in the economy, they only contribute 22% to the labor force. Now, many, my debate is as a clear case of meritocracy, but the point is that it is not about merit. It is not about intelligence. It is not about how worthy you are to fit the bill. It is about representation. It is about giving an equal opportunity for women to enter the workforce, which is missing. Now, coming to agriculture, we all know that we are an agriculturist economy. Here also, there is extreme underrepresentation of women, which is 8.5%. Now, for the economy, the new economy that we all are well-versed with, which is the startup economy or the business economy, you'll be very surprised to know that even there, women across India are only 3% of the businesses across India are run by women. So again, not a case of meritocracy at all. It is about not getting them the right kind of avenues, the right kind of support system for a women entrepreneurs to actually take charge of the of their businesses or their startups. Now coming to the next slide. So in India, though the feminist movement started a little late, but in India also in tandem with the four waves of feminism that we had seen across the globe, in India also there has been movement towards feminism. So in India it is divided in three parts: phase one, phase two, and phase three. Now the phase one of feminism is when British colonization of India happened. So that is when the first time women started in India, because India was a very divided society, as in the women were relegated to the caregiving duties at home and a man was only supposed to be the breadwinner model. Therefore, the women in Indian history have been very limited to certain aspects of the society only. When British colonization happened, that is where Indian women actually saw other aspects or other progressive aspects of feminism which were already had taken cognizance in the English speaking world, that is the UK. So that is when women started actually getting notice of the first wave and the second wave of feminism. But before feminism could take its charge in India, there was a mass disorientation in the caste and religion aspects in India. There was, as we all know, during the British rule, there was a mass conversion in India into Christianity. And a lot of women who belonged to the other religion, BHP, Hinduism, Islam, started losing their understanding of their own self. So it is very important to understand that during the pre-British colonization time, identity of people in India originated from and developed from caste and religion. And that is when, if you take away caste or religion from people, they are left without any guards. They are left without any identity. And that is exactly what happened with Indian women. Because there was a mass conversion, whatever they were taught in their respective religion were now not holding truth. And that is where they started losing their own self-identity. However, this phase also saw, and one has to give due credit to certain feminist movements that had a trickle-down effect from the English-speaking world, that is the UK, that certain very ill practices in India started coming out in open and started being debated on. Most of these ill practices were sati, infanticide, education, and property rights. So we all know what sati is, and we all know what infanticide is. So these were were very prevalent practices, and these were the practices which were considered as a norm and were not debated on. But due to the British regime, due to this another race coming and coming and taking control of India, that women in India started delving deep into understanding whether these practices, be it be sati, infanticide, or no property rights, actually are good for them, or they are only relegated to them or given to them because of their minority status in the society. Now, coming to the phase two of feminism. So phase two of feminism is started with India's fight against the British regime. So Mahatma Gandhi started the resistance movement against the British regime. And that is when Mahatma Gandhi, because he was educated outside, because he had a very progressive understanding to the feminist movement, he started inviting the women workforce to take part, the women to take part in the independence movement, in the Poorn Swaraj movement. And that is the first time women, with the support of the leadership, which was obviously Mahatma Gandhi's leadership, started going outside the four walls of their home. They started experiencing the world without the status of somebody's wife, daughter, or sister, or mother. So this is when their participation in the workforce started. It basically started from the resistance movement, but then they started doing the other party work. They started making the posters. They started signing the documents. They started holding the placards. So all these started giving more identity to the women. Also, this is a time when working class of women established. Now, as I mentioned, that women were not just relegated to joining the Poorn Swaraj movement. They were also taking part into making sure that this movement is successful. That is the first time working class, that is working class beyond the unpaid care labor at home, was established in the broader understanding of things. And this is when two very important organizations in India related to women were established. First one is AIWC, which is All India Women Conference. And the second is NFIW, which is National Federation of Indian Women. So these were women organizations that were working for women rights, had leadership as women, and were focused only on making sure that women have equitable visibility and equitable understanding of the world at large. Now, coming to the phase three of feminism in India. So phase three of feminism is what we define feminism from 1947 to hence. After that also there was a phase four of feminism, which we will discuss in the next slide. But phase three of the feminism is after India gained independence and the working class, which was established in India through the phase two of feminism, started occupying the independent leadership positions in various organizations, in legislatures, in property rights, in also in the government. And that is when feminism actually started holding a lot of backing. However, this is also the time, because India had gained independence, that certain evil practices, specifically of class divide and caste divide, started seeing a day in feminism. So the class divide, not just economic class divide, but also social class divide as to the what part of the society that do the women belong to, started emerging. And these class divides weakened the feminist movement, because it was not anymore about solidarity movement. It was basically about the bigger fish in the market eating or getting the meaty positions. So class divide also made sure that obviously the DBA, the Dalit, Bahujan and Adivasi part of the society suffered the most, because they were again sent back to the roots of the entire work done in the second wave of feminism, where each and everyone could join the workforce movement, where each and everyone from the various classes and various castes could join the solidarity movement, was again nullified to zero. However, during the second phase of feminism, there were obviously, as any feminist movement, there were also certain good aspects that emerged from the second wave of feminism. The first one being sexual divide at the workplace started emerging, as in women started experiencing subtle or provocative sexual harassment at workplace, and at least started delving around it and believing that this is not normal. Female infanticide because of the India's independence status, because of women being a part of represented legislatures, infanticide and laws against infanticide started emerging and started started being established. And similarly, through this, because of work around gendered violence, or because of work around female infanticide, because of representation of women at the legislature, patriarchy within the religion, within household, within the economy, were started being a part of the national debates. And this is where gender-based violence, be it be in the matrimony or against the matrimony, also became a part of the debate. And that is where our constitution, our various other statutes were devised. So if we understand the constitution and we understand the various other statutes specifically related to women, specifically related to rights of an individual, they're all equitable. There is no divide of the constitution or the statutes between the different genders. So that is when, for the first time, women as an equal asset to the society were recognized during the phase three of feminism. That is when the constitutional and the framework, law framework in India were established. Now coming to phase four of feminism. So phase four of feminism is 2018, and hence not many feminists recognize this feminism, this phase of feminism, because they've always believed that LGBTQI community has always existed amongst the gendered minorities, but it's just that they were not given legal status. So therefore, phase four of feminism is redundant. However, phase four of feminism in a demography like India holds value is because, as I mentioned, India, any kind of gender advocacy is not right or wrong. A lot of it depends upon the socio-cultural fabric that we live in and how we have progressed. And phase four of feminism in 2018, when LGBTQI community were given a legal sanction, was a big fight, a big win, a big victory for feminists across India. Because it was the time where all the where gender was not regarded as a binary anymore. When women who belong to a spectrum of gender were also able to come out and declare their preferences, where sexuality was not just a hush-hush topic inside the bedroom, but was a topic of nature, was a topic of norm. So phase four of feminism is when legal sanction was given to the LGBTI community. And right now we are in phase B of phase four of feminism, because just giving them a legal sanction is not important. Giving any gendered minority a legal sanction is not important. As we have seen through the first four waves of feminism across the globe, or first three feminist movements across India, is that feminism only will emerge and become stronger when gender inclusive civil rights are given to the gendered minorities. And phase part two of the phase four of feminism is giving gender inclusive civil rights to the LGBTQI community, for which the work is already ongoing. Now coming to the next slide, please. Now, the teaser to today's webinar was that feminism is the new F word. It is one of the most hated words that you would see in the urban dictionary. There are a lot of innuendos passed according to feminism, a lot of misappropriate words that are attached to feminism, be it be feminazi or femi bitches or whatnot. But how does feminism suddenly gravitate to become such an unholy word, where throughout the 1830s, since the 1837, we have seen feminist movements being a movement where all the genders were taken into cognizance, where even the socialist movement across the globes were taken into cognizance. And it was a movement not just for improvement or for equal positioning of women or of genders, but it also take into consideration the world becoming a more expansive place to live in, the world becoming a more embracing place to live in. So let's come to the myths attached to feminism. The first is misandry. I mean, I don't even have to say it, that profess how misfortunate is that all feminists are smothered down into being misandrous. That is, they have extreme hatred for men. it is the myth which is the most prevalent, and it is the myth which is supposed to be most debated on, because feminists are never against a particular gender. Rather, feminists, because they have been on the receiving end of being a gendered minority, have believed in equality of all genders. Yes, the hatred is towards power dynamics. The hatred is towards one particular gender getting to sit on the high end of the table. So it is never about hating the men. It is about maybe men getting to be the decision makers in the society without taking consideration of the views, the opinions, the ideology, or the needs of the other genders. Feminism was necessary in the past, but is not necessary now. Yes, so there's a lot of debate around it that we do not need. So there is a bill pending in India, which is the reservation for representation of women in the legislature, which is where the women are demanding 33% reservation, which is again being debated a lot, that women today are able to go out, they're able to be economically independent, they have education to harness on. So why do they need representation, or why maybe in the metro there needs to be a special bogie only limited for the benefit of women. So here the thing is that we have to understand the representation. You and I today having this webinar are 0.01% of the privileged class of people. 65% of the women, specifically in a demography like India, are underprivileged. They need to have a voice of their own. And here I would like to mention a physics theory that I read a few days back. It's called the class mass theory, which says that even if a mass, which is extremely potent, is extremely valuable, holds a lot of energy in it, if it is kept alone amongst the other masses, that mass is going to lose its credibility. And that is where feminism getting its equal representation, or today also talking about feminism as an ideology, is important, because there's underrepresentation of women and genders at leadership roles. Some people also believe that feminists, the other agenda of feminists, is matriarchy, which is absolutely wrong. Again, as I mentioned, feminists throughout the history, throughout the global past, have been on the receiving end of things. So they don't believe in matriarchy. They have rather never believed in one gender holding the power, or one gender being the decision maker in a society or in a household. Feminism is about equality. It is about equal opportunity, be it be economic, political, social, health, to the entire gender spectrum. So feminism is not equal to matriarchy, it is rather equal to equality. Feminine refers to women only. So most of us have known about various movements around feminism which have asked for ally support, because feminism as an ideology has believed in a pluralist society where we believe that one single gender can never advocate or can never make a revolutionary movement successful. So feminism is about all the people, the entire gender spectrum, which believes that that there has to be equal distribution of rights amongst the entire gender to come and stand as allies to the feminist movement. So feminism is not about women only, it is about the entire gender spectrum. All feminists are bra-burning radicals. So a lot of credit to this actually goes to the misrepresented image that the digital and the social media has established about women, about feminists, who are these angry women who are going out on the roads, burning their bras and displaying their body anatomy in hate towards the power, in hate towards the legislature. It has nothing to do with radicals. Radicals have emerged in every revolutionary movement. It is just that in feminism, it's given a dirty name. Feminism feminists across the globe are relegated to being people who are rebelling without a cause. So that gives feminism a bad name, because it's not about going against the norms. It is about going against the norms which are evil. It is about going against the norms which are oppressive and regressive. Feminism is only for the middle class white women. So here also it is very important to understand that what we discuss in the waves of feminism across the globe and in India, class divide, caste divide, have been two foundation of feminist movement, which has made feminist movement strong, but has also made feminist movement very weak. So be it be about white supremacy or be it be about the Brahmin class in India. So it is believed that only the middle, and that too only the whites, need the feminist movement, is because the other, the blacks or the browns or the various other races across the globe don't have any understanding of feminism, and therefore they will not gain any benefit about feminism. And why the middle class women? Is because the elite anyway enjoy a lot of privilege in the society, and the lower middle class or the lower class do not have the ability to deal with the privilege of feminism. So that is also a very wrong ideology. Feminism is for each and everyone who wants to have an equitable position in the society. Feminism is beyond class, caste, and gender. All feminists are lesbians. So again, I mean, I don't know even if we even should start addressing it, that how lame and how imbecile this particular statement and this particular myth is, that had all feminists been lesbians, then I think we would never have ally support. We would, the entire pride would be only about one particular aspect of the gender, where feminist is all about gender not being binary anymore. Men can't be feminists. This again goes down to feminism. It refers to women only. Only through ally support can feminism be achieved, can equality be achieved, and men have an equal part to play to make sure that feminism is established. Now in the UN, I'm sure most of you are aware about he for she campaign. It was a very successful campaign, and it is an ongoing campaign where men have come out and have shown their support as allies, as feminists, to make sure that feminist movement is established. So men or any other gender, and specifically the supreme aspect of the gender, can be as feminist as the ones who have been oppressed and violated. All feminists are career women and do not support stay-at-home moms. So this is something that is going, this is a myth of feminism which is emerged in the fourth phase of feminism, and in the fourth phase of feminism, both in India and in global, that feminism is all about women having economic independence, or women going out and earning their own money, and women not, and feminist movement or career oriented women dissing on women who want to stay at home. What we need to really understand is feminism is about choice. It is about choice, that if a woman doesn't want to work on her ambitions and wants to be a mother or wants to be a caregiver at home, then it's a choice, and she is as feminist as a woman who is holding the tabs in a boardroom. So feminism is not about me holier than thou, or I am better than you because I am earning bread, because I am going out and establishing my visibility in the society. Feminism is about choice, whatever suits whoever. So that is where feminism actually holds value. Feminists don't believe in marriage. Again, choice. It is an equal dynamics of choice. The people who want to get married can get married. The people who want to have a child can have a child. The feminists who want to not do any of these two things should also have a choice, a consent, and respect for not following the other two stated norms. If you are a feminist, you cannot be religious. So this emerged from basically a lot of societies where religion is very important, including India, because feminism counters the regressive or the secondhand position that is given to women across the globe, be it be in the form of abortion laws or marital laws or property laws. So just because women have countered, or genders have countered, the establishments of religion, that doesn't mean they are not religious. They can be religious, they can be spiritual, but they don't have to adhere to all the norms of religion that have been carried forward from generations and cultures and various other centuries. So back in time, if Manuvad was the establishment of Hinduism as a philosophy, but today, obviously, I mean, there are a lot of counters even attached to Manuvad, but that doesn't mean that women or feminists who counter Manuvad do not believe in Hinduism as a philosophy. They can or they may not. I mean, that's a personal choice, but it's not a generic statement that feminists who counter religion do not believe in religion. They counter religion because their understanding of religion is so expansive that they understand religion to be inclusive of all the genders. Now, coming to the next slide, please. So now that we have understood the history, the emergence, the ideologies that were being practiced, the myths attached to feminism, then how is it that feminism today has become such a nasty word that, you know, it's actually become a curse for even the women who have fought against regressive and patriarchal ideologies. So let's understand that what are these various aspects or what are these various bullets that have made feminism earn a bad name. Now, radical versus liberal. Now, across the globe, people or socioeconomic fabrics have divided feminists into two parts. One is radical and one is liberal. So radical feminism is where radical feminism is a feminism that emerged during the third wave of feminism across the globe, where women started believing that they could go out and revolt against any kind of supremacy without understanding whether it is befitting a sociocultural fabric, whether it is befitting time. And that is a feminism that is regressive, and that is a feminism that boils down to only hate in the society. Liberal feminism takes cognizance of the socio-cultural fabric that we belong to. It takes cognizance to the need of the society, and it takes cognizance to the inclusivity of all the people, including men. So liberal feminism is the feminism which helps feminism establish and grow, and radical feminism gives a very conservative viewpoint to feminism. Secondly, that's what they said. Due to easy availability of information on digital media, on social media, on WhatsApps and various other resources, we have started to believe feminism as what was passed to us through people, through generations, or through even a family structure. People do not really go into delving deep into the depths of from where a particular statement about feminism or a particular ideology emerged. And that is why today we have studied the history of feminism to understand that feminism has also gone through its ups and downs. And that is what the history has been votary for. It is not because somebody said it to us. It is because we delve deep into the history to understand the various phases of feminism. So this hearsay evidence that is attached to feminism is making feminism earn a bad name. Now, misappropriation of ally support. So here what has happened is that feminism and even the gendered minorities across the globe have believed or have... this is actually a very debated point, because certain feminists believe that because gendered minorities need to have a voice of their own, and that is why ally support is only supposed to be in background, which has given a dissatisfactory image to the ally support. But what is required is awareness. Because the gendered minorities for centuries together, for periods together, have not had a voice, they want ally support as only support and not to become their voice. So misappropriation of ally support is also a reason where the allies think that feminists across the globe are only using them as puppets to advance their goal. But due to lack of awareness, they haven't really understood the socio-cultural fabric that feminism and the gendered minorities are coming from. They want support, but they don't want the allies to do their talking. Now, sensationalism versus real issues. So we all know that lies are more saleable in the market than the boring truth. So a feminist who has used the power of the work that has been done by the fast feminists to her privilege by misappropriating facts and misappropriating ideologies is given a broader name than, say, an educator who has been working really hard to make sure right to education is established. And the sensational part of feminism, that is the wrong part of feminism, that gets more eyes, that gets more wants on social media is established as a generic understanding of feminism. So truth is never saleable. Truth is boring. It is only the sensationalism of feminism that holds that establishes gravity and is given a generic understanding about feminism. Now, uncensored digital dissemination of views. Now, before the advancement of digital media, we all know that be it be in the form of academic literature papers or research papers, that there was a very, the eyes of scrutiny were very strong. But today, because there is no scrutiny on the digital media, on dissemination of information on digital media through WhatsApps, etc., anybody who has any kind of understanding of feminism or any kind of opinions about feminism is able to circulate them. And these become facts without having any evidence to their support. And that, in most cases, is against a feminist movement, against a revolutionary movement. And that is where feminism starts earning a very bad name. Now, power play of narrative. So this is very important to understand that power dynamics. So whoever, whichever gender holds the power in a geography, be it be in the government, be it be in the executive, in the judiciary, in the administrative, starts very naturally to devise policies, to devise ideologies which are benefiting their particular gender. So there have been cases of various, specifically in India also, I'm sure most of us are aware, how power dynamics in legislature has misnomered or given a bad name to feminism. They have associated feminists as angry women who hate men or angry women who are rebelling without a cause. And the last is lack of awareness. So whatever the reasons that we have read right now, be it be radical versus the liberal or misappropriation of ally support, all this, the ground of all this emerges from lack of awareness. Because there is no talking, because there is no discussion, because there is no support to understanding how feminist movements were established, why they were necessary, what are the struggles they went through, what was the criticism attached to them, is because that adds to lack of awareness. And anybody who finds it convenient can attach his own ideology, his own understanding to feminism. Now, coming to the next slide, please. So why do we need feminism? As we discussed, that is 2020, do we really need feminism today, or is it just about women, again, rebelling without a cause? So today also, I mean, if you run data also around it, women are the center of body shaming. So be it be about all this talk about body positivity is amongst the very privileged women. So body shaming is again a norm in the society, and women are the centrifugal point of body shaming. Female nudity is used to sell tabloid newspapers. Deepika Padukone's cleavage on the Times of India's first page was why Times of India started getting a lot of readership across India. That is because women's anatomy is not just a centrifugal point of desire. It is also the reason for a lot of hate. It is a reason for a lot of contempt. It is a reason for a lot of carnal desires to emerge. Smart people are usually male, while females are dumb but attractive. So, because of movies, because of books, because of various other established platforms, this is a norm that is established that women are supposed to be these damsels in distress, and a man has to come and uphold them, has to come and protect them, has to come and give them two cents, give women two cents of information, or just help them to establish an identity of their own. The paranoia of humorless, selfish, man-hating, and aggressive women. So there are two paths. Either women are supposed to be dumb, stupid people who don't understand the science of things, or the other aspect is that women are supposed to be these boring, these non-fun people who are only doing morchas and who are only rebelling. So to break through these two identities, that very easily the entire world divides women into. Either they are divided as desirable or they're divided as nerds. So for this, women to break through these stereotypes, feminism is required. Now, underrepresentation of women in leadership roles, as we've already discussed, 14.4% contribute to the GDP in India. In the startup arena, only 3% businesses are led by women. And because of this underrepresentation of women in leadership roles, the policies, the various other laws, statutes, the various reforms related to establishment of women don't really happen because they're not considered important. Now, pay gap, I mean, I don't even have to disclose it or go into the depths of it, that in given any career field, any economic opportunity, there is a huge pay gap between the various genders, despite the fact that they are doing equal work or they're graduated with equal amount of caliber. Now, FGM, which is female genital mutilation. This, though, is a criminal offense in the country, but in the underprivileged, in the backward areas of India, this is still a very prevalent practice. And we need feminism. We need to talk about women sexual desires, women sexual and reproductive health, so that FGM is totally abolished in the country. No choice and consent. In the last 4 or 5 years, we have heard a lot of debate, lot of noise around choice and consent, which was not even prevalent in the past times. Even today, marital rape is not a crime in the country because it is supposed to be a very normal byproduct of a matrimony. But choice and consent is now that women have started. Choice and consent is something that, though, is now gaining a little bit of backing, but there has to be more talks about it so that laws can be changed, laws can be amended, and even ideologies about consent, about choice, can be spread out. Gender violence. So in the last 2-3 weeks of the lockdown, we have seen a 24% rise in domestic violence cases. So this is just in the last 2-3 weeks of the lockdown. So gender violence is the most reported violence in the country and the most unaccounted violence also, be it be sexual, physical, emotional, mental, verbal violence at workplace. So we need equal opportunity in these areas. We want to talk about violence that happens at various aspects of the society, and that is why we need feminism. And the last is power dynamics. As we discussed, through various underrepresentation of women in leadership roles, through pay gap, through choice and consent, all this boils down to power dynamics. Even today, despite privileged women having economic independence, the power dynamics in a household, in the society at large, is tilted towards men. Because they have enjoyed privilege from various centuries, from the past centuries, from the past societies, from decades at their behest, power dynamics is tilted toward them. And power dynamics doesn't only mean that they decide what happens in a household. Power dynamics also make sure that appropriation of funds for women empowerment are very small, because the power dynamics at the legislature is tilted towards men. So therefore, women empowerment, women establishment, opportunities for women, sexual and reproductive health for women are not given any weightage. For a very small example, even during the pandemic time, sanitary napkins have not been associated as an essential commodity. Why? Because the legislature is represented by one gender, which obviously has nothing to do with menstruation. And that is why they don't think that menstruation or sanitary napkins or any kind of menstrual health is supposed to be an essential commodity during the lockdown times. So this is why even in today, in 2020, we need feminism. Now, coming to the next slide, please. Yeah, so because our work is underpaid, established or unpaid, unpaid is your caregiving labor at home. What we like is more important than what we do. And if we get raped, it is our fault. I mean, this is something which, a quote which we have all read on social media, the size of my skirt doesn't decide how I am observed as a sexual entity or as a woman. And if we love women, it's because we can't get a real man. Again, LGBTQIA. And if we stand up for our rights, we are loud. And if we don't, we are typical weak females, dividing the women between two aspects, nerd and go-getters. And if we want to get married, we are out to trap a man. If we don't, we are unnatural. And if we object to being sex objects, we have no sense of humor. And for many, many, many reasons, we are feminist. So that will be all from me. Thank you so much for being so patient and for sailing through this entire history and various very heavy duty geographies and ideologies that we have discussed. But I would love to hear from you and render any kind of questions or any kind of dissent or anything that you understand from feminism.
Okay, thank you. That was a very insightful and an informative session. I think it gives us a lot of outlets to introspect, think, learn and unlearn. And I guess we'll just move ahead with the question and answer session now. So all of you who are viewing this session, if you have any questions at all, you can write them in the chat box and Pallavi will read them and answer them one by one. Pallavi, can you see the questions questions icon like right below the chat?
Yes, I can. Yeah.
Great. Do we have questions?
Misusing. Of course, there have been a lot of cases. Let us not name talk a particular movement which has disregarded feminism. But even today, what's happening in the US where women, where there have been a lot of revolution around that I wouldn't wear a mask because it is my body and my choice, is misappropriation of feminism. Because you have to understand that there's certain aspects where you can't go on against the norm. You can't go against the health or the rights of a mass public. So that is misusing feminism. You can't use my body, my choice against a pandemic that the world is going through. Doesn't the concept of reservation for women defeat the purpose of feminism? This is very, very interesting. So, we discussed that there has been a lot of debate about it, that it is a case of either merit or it is a case of reservation. But one, we have to understand. Okay, so let me give an example. So in the UK, when Tony Blair was elected came to the parliament, he had made he had elected an entire cabinet of women, which were about 6-7 women, but they were called as Tony, and I'm really sorry for using this language, but that is how these women were called. They were called as Blair's bitches. And these women, despite being feminist in their own regime, were not able to make a single policy for the empowerment of women. Why? Because of underrepresentation. What happens is that until and unless women are represented with their allies, they will not be able to take forward an ideology. So one woman, one vote will not really make a change. And it is only through ally support are women able to recognize that there are certain things that need to be advocated or need to be advanced. So it is never a case of meritocracy. It is a case of representation. You remember the glass ceiling and a glass cliff concept? So glass ceiling means that women break through the glass ceiling and are able to have a voice of their own in the economy, which is dominated by men. But glass cliff means that even when they reach that representation, they will fall off the glass cliff because they do not have other women backing them up. So that is why we need reservation for women. Do you feel that the classification of feminism as liberal, socialist, cultural, and radical is wrong? I don't know if wrong or right, but yes, that is monolithical. Feminism can never be divided according to all these classes. There is always overlapping of all these views, and that is why it is very necessary that we gain insights from history and do not define ourselves in any of these fabrics. Either liberal, socialist, there's also Marxist, there is also radical, there is men haters. There are all kind of definitions that one can attach to feminism, but it cannot be monolithical. Feminism is a revolutionary movement which takes into cognizance the entire gender. So how can one ideology define feminism? Or rather, if there is one ideology that defines feminism, that is about equality, which is over and above all these small definitions of liberal, socialist, radical, cultural, and the others. How should one deal with sexism in, say, the workplace, college, or family, since it's a tricky area? Very important question. So it is very important to know who your support is and who are you going against. National Commission for Women, under its various other organization, and I'm sure in whichever organization you're working, there has to be a sexual harassment cell. If there is not, there are various NGOs who are working in these directions. It is very important that any kind of sexism is brought under the sight of these various NGOs and these various civil societies, so that you can be supported in your fight towards sexism or any kind of gendered misappropriation. But it is also necessary to augment one's understanding. There are many times that we understand a privilege or understand our demands to be under the ambit of sexism. But first is awareness, and second is seeking ally support, and then obviously having the courage to voice out whatever your concerns are. What would be an ideal response to Men Too movement undermining the Me Too movement? I mean, see, of course, I mean, there is no denying in saying that men are not harassed or men are not abused or men are dowry cases are not fabricated. There is. And Men Too movement that can never undermine the Me Too movement is again about representation. So if you look at the data, it is, I mean, there have been talks about in the future world, we to live in a society where we can equally as genders pass, uploading comments to each other for the how physically we look. Like right now, if somebody calls me certain names because of my physicality, that would be taken as sexism according to me. But women debate that women also call out men. But that's about representation. What is the data around it? When men are harassed or men are not able to voice out their concern about harassment, let's get down to how many women are harassed. So they cannot never be undermining, but we cannot negate it that men are not harassed. What are some of the concrete steps can take to fight for gender equality as a teenager? Okay, so the first is Nandini, that because you because I am assuming that you are a woman, so when you talk about teenagers taking a fight against gender equality, it is very necessary that you are able to voice out your concerns, that you are able, that you call periods and not call them with other names if you are talking about it with your other groups. And even when you take, even with your opinions, you make sure that there is no unconscious gender bias. You have to train yourself to understand that anything that you say, believe, or voice out needs to be from an unconscious gender bias. So that is how you can establish gender equality. And most important is that as a teenager, please make sure that you really work to understand women rights movement, that you really, if you're interested, you delve deeper into the subject rather than backing on hearsay evidence. Please augment your understanding about socioeconomic occurrences and the gendered outcome. But there might be possibility that due to the reservation criteria, a man who is more qualified than a specific woman doesn't get selected. Of course, when two bulls fight, the crop suffers. But we have to look at the bigger understanding of things. What does the society need? The society right now needs a 50-50 world. The society right now needs that we are able to fulfill India's goal of social inclusion when India turns 75 in 2022. And that can only be possible when we give certain amount of privilege to the gendered minority. See, I completely understand, Sanya, where you're coming from, that that it is that why, as women, because we have suffered social disapproval through generations together, why are we supposed to do the same to men? But this is you and I talking from a very privileged mindset. We are not catering to the needs of the 65% of women who may not even have access to internet today. So for those women, We need representation. We need the legislature, the policymakers, the executive, the decision makers of the corporate economy to be a 50-50 society. Is intersectionality an important part of feminism? How interconnected are both of them? So we've discussed it throughout the phase three and four of world global feminism and intersectionality, even in India after 2018 377 judgment. Intersectionality is a very important aspect of feminism, both in regard to gender intersectionality and caste and class intersectionality. The caste system in India is actually the foundation of all kind of economic upheaval. And therefore, we need to take into cognizance the caste intersectionality and the class intersectionality. Do you feel that a particular wave could have taken an alternative approach in order to attain their particular objectives? Yes, I think phase three of feminism, yes, where we started giving more onus to class and caste rather than the solidarity movement. No movement, specifically a big revolutionary movement like feminist movement, can ever be accomplished without solidarity. I mean, we don't live in isolation. And the world is far too complex for a single gendered minority to accomplish the greater good. Therefore, I believe that phase three feminism could have a more impact. And because of phase three, phase four feminism could have a deeper impact. What we are going through now is phase three feminism had focused a little more on solidarity rather than succumbing to class, caste, and the fight between the elite and the working class. How big a problem do you think is the fact that underrepresentation of women political leaders in Indian government setup will always broaden the gap between implementation of most stringent modern inclusive laws for not only women, but the LGBTQI community? This is absolutely right. And that is why, as a lawyer, as a woman, I am absolutely in support of the 33% reservation that the new bill is demanding in the legislature for women, is because it is a fact. Very small thing. I mean, I'm sure the government wouldn't have to spend billions to make sanitary napkins an essential commodity under the Essential Commodities Act. But it is the lack of understanding is because of lack of underrepresentation of it. So we need representation from the entire gender spectrum. And that is why, you know, even in corporate economy, like, I know for sure that McKinsey is running these campaigns specifically in the lockdown times, where they're asking representation from the LGBTQI community in their decision-making roles. It's because we need these communities to come out in the global space as their own sexuality and to put forward the various needs and requirements of their genders. So if there is no representation, I don't see a very bright future for gender equality. Could you please explain more about ally support? There is LGBTQI community and there is then heterosexual community. So heterosexual community has to give the support to the LGBTQI community to advance their goals for economic independence and social inclusion, where we do not regard gender as a binary. So even in the prides, if I don't know if how many of you have been part of the prides, there is an ally support. As a cis heterosexual woman, me myself, I completely believe in supporting the LGBTQI community, because as an ally, I understand, as a gendered minority, as a woman, I understand that until and unless as an ally, I give support to them, they will not be able to talk about their inclusion in a society at large. Similarly, when we talk about he for she or men coming out as an ally support to women empowerment, it basically means that men also support the idea of gender equality in the world at large. As an essential commodity during the lockdown. Yes, this was only after a lot of debate in the parliament that happened. Otherwise, if you read the Essential Commodity Act 1957, and I'm assuming in 1957 also, they were menstruators. Sanitary napkins or even other essential commodities for pregnant women were not given essential commodity status. But only, and that law has not been changed. It is only an addendum to the Essential Commodities Act. How can we promote gender neutral problem nurturing? Because I think by doing so, we can cope with the... Yes. So I am gender neutral, nurturing. So I'm assuming you're talking about childcare, child nurturing. So this is a very interesting topic. Right now I am co-leading a research by the Indian Council of Medical Research on gendered belief in children 6 to 8 years. And we are almost on the stage of conclusion of that longitudinal study, which says that a child between the 6 to 8 years, because of gendered nurturing, is able to devise the genders under traditional and non-traditional roles, devise the genders under various boxes, which later on leads to a youth force in the country which already has a gender conscious. So gender neutral upbringing of the child is actually nipping gender conscious behavior in the bud. It is extremely important that the child is nurtured without any kind of gender bias. And that starts from your books, to the way the child is dressed, to the activities the child indulges in. And that actually will be a very essential part of the gender equality movement. There are also talk in the new education policy 2020-2021, where comprehensive sexuality education, which is a curriculum by the virtue of which unconscious gender behavior or unconscious gender nurturing is nipped in the bud during the formative years, will become a part of the new education policy. I think we just went to a lockdown, but in March 2020, there was a new education policy national consultation where very strong steps were taken to make sure that CSE becomes a comprehensive sexuality education becomes a mandatory part of the school curriculums. But feminism shouldn't mean 50-50. Shouldn't mean that while getting chosen, rejected for a particular job or any other thing for that matter, one doesn't consider the gender of the person. Whoever is more qualified gets it, and more policies shouldn't be more concerned about educating awareness every towards a kind of policy. Absolutely right, Sanya. But Sanya, this you were talking about, this is the utopian world that you're talking about, where gender is not taken into consideration while giving jobs, while giving promotions. Now, it has happened, but in very close quarters, it has happened. I have been a votary to it, where your promotions in a law firm are taken into consideration if the woman is married or is bearing a child, because it is taken for granted that if a woman gets married, if a woman has a child, then her priorities would shift to the household rather than to the workforce. So what you are saying is the idealist situation. Gender should never be about a job. Feminism should never be about giving gravity to a particular gender. But we also have to understand the reality of things. We are living in a world where there is gender bias, where there is no representation, where the leadership roles in the corporate economy have an unconscious gender bias towards men. So first, we have to take cognizance of the situation that we are in, rather than living in a utopian land. This is the idealist situation, but this is not the situation right now. And this is not going to be a situation up till 2030. That is when we establish a world of 50-50 representation. Yeah, gender neutral. Yeah, Shivani, got it. How do you think internalized sexism can be rooted out and then can be subsequently destroyed? This is extremely important, and you don't have to hold yourself against the wall if there is, a conscious gender behavior on your ground, because this is the way we have been groomed. The first time you think of, the first time you think about a chef, the first person, the first gender that comes into your understanding is actually a man. Or the first time you think about a nurse, the first gender that comes to your head is of a woman. So we have been so much trained to address gender roles according to a particular gender that it's going to be a fight. But the important thing is to check ourselves. The important thing is to check ourselves at every ground. The important thing is to check that when Shilpa Shetty gave birth to a child through surrogacy, that we did not think then, why was she not potent enough, or did she not have a good sexual life with her husband? It is about choice. And similarly, checking yourself, reading yourself, making sure that our language is very gender neutral, and asking people, being the first to ask people, what are the pronouns that they want to be addressed with, and to make sure that we do not disregard any kind of advancement or any kind of choice or consent established by one gender. By that, I think most of our unconscious gender behavior will be at bay. I think that's about it. I don't think I have more questions.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for coming on this webinar and educating us so much about it. We had a great time, and I'm sure all of us learned a lot. It was an absolute pleasure.
Thank you so much, Sanskriti. I absolutely loved it. And it is wonderful when the cohort becomes this interactive. And, you know, without any bias, we are able to bring out all our understanding about feminism to board, because that is what feminism is. Even if it is wrong, let's debate it. Let's disagree with each other so that solidarity movement is formed.
Absolutely. All right, then. Thank you so much. Hope to see you soon.
Thank you. Hope to see you soon too. Please take care of yourself.
Yes, take care. Bye.
Bye.